Good evening, everyone. My name is Miklo Shede, and I'm the head of the Department of Philosophy, Logic, and Scientific Method at the London School of Economics. Welcome to this public lecture by Professor Carlo Rovelli. Thank you for your interest. Thank you for coming. This lecture is hosted by the department jointly with the Center for the Philosophy of Natural and Social Sciences at the LSE. And it is part of a three-day conference which is going on the LSE campus these days. And this conference is the 18th UK European Foundations of Physics Conference, sponsored by these institutions, by LSE, and also by the British Society for the Philosophy of Science. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to present you today's speaker, Professor Carlo Rovelli. Professor Rovelli is a leading theoretical physicist. He studied in Italy, in Bologna, and Padua. He received his PhD in physics in Padua, and he has held positions at several universities, including the Imperial College London here, which we are proud of, and Trieste, Yale, Syracuse University, as also the University of Pittsburgh, before settling, it seems, in the University of Marseille, where he is now a distinguished professor. Unselfishly, Professor Rovelli has taken on responsibilities of serving on the editorial boards of major journals in theoretical and mathematical physics. For instance, he served on the Journal of Mathematical Physics, Classical and Quantum Gravity, Nuovo Cimento, and most recently, since January this year, he's the editor-in-chief of Foundations of Physics, which is the major journal devoted to conceptual foundations of modern physics. For participants of the conference on this side of the room, I would like to repeat again that there will be a special edition of Foundations of Physics, which was initiated by Professor Rovelli. And I'm also instructed to announce that our other major journal in the field, the Studies in History and Philosophy of Modern Physics, is following suit, so there will be a special edition of the studies as well. You will receive information about this in due course. Professor Rovelli is best known for his work on quantum gravity. He's one of the founding fathers of loop quantum gravity, which is a particular approach which intends to unify or merge, at least, the two fundamental modern physical theories, quantum theory and the theory of relativity, gravitation theory in particular. But Professor Rovelli is not just known by those strange people who worry about these esoteric things like loop quantum gravity. He is also known by the general public, and he's known for two reasons. One reason is that his interests are much wider. In particular, he is interested in philosophy, relevantly for today's talk. And also, he is known because he's a great communicator. He's very keen on sharing his knowledge about physics. And more importantly, perhaps, he's very keen on sharing his enthusiasm about all sorts of knowledge, including physical knowledge. In harmony with this, he is a very prolific author. He has published more than 200 papers published in major journals in physics. He has also published 4 books. I'm mentioning 4 of these books. The first one is on quantum gravity. It was published by Cambridge University Press in 2004, and it has become the standard reference on quantum gravity. A more recent book, co-authored jointly with another author, is Covariant Quantum Gravity, which was published in 2014, relatively recently, and I'm sure it is going to become a major reference in the field as well. Another book which I'd like to mention here is the 7 Brief Lectures in Physics, This has become a bestseller, originally published in Italian and then translated into all sorts of languages, including English. And in fact, this book is going to be available for purchase after the lecture, so I'm told, I'm hoping that the publisher is bringing the books. So Professor Rovelli is very kindly agreed that he's going to sign the book for those who are interested. You're very welcome after the lecture to do so. The fourth book I would like to mention is a book on philosophy, on a particular figure. The title of the book is The First Scientist, Anaximander and His Legacy. This book shows Professor Rovelli's keen interest in philosophy, and it's a lovely book. I recommend it for everyone to read. It was originally written in Italian and French. French, I think, is the original language. And then it was translated into English. So in view of all these, I think it is perfectly suiting that he's giving a lecture today which concerns the relation of physics and philosophy. And I'm very pleased that he has accepted this invitation. So please welcome Professor Rovelli.
Thank you very much.
Sound okay?
Yeah. Thank you, Miklos, very much. Thank you for all of you to be here. I'm very honored to have this public, this mixed public, in fact, and divided public, because if I understand correctly, this two-thirds sort of general audience, and that's are the philosophers, right? This is the so in preparing this, what to tell you, I in fact hesitated whether I should talk to them or to you or to you or to them. I apologize, I decided to talk a little bit, but I hope to say something useful or, well, something relevant. What I'm gonna talk about is this: physics is hard. This is how much. So that's a usual situation of a theoretical physicist working. That doesn't work. And the question is, can philosophy help? Does physics need philosophy? Let me say that during the conference the last couple of days, I asked a lot of philosophers of them to help tell me why, in which sense, philosophy is useful to physics. And the most common answer I got is it? So this is not a standard defense of philosophy from a philosopher. First, because I'm not a philosopher, I'm a physicist. And second, because in fact, as I said, the most common reaction of a philosopher of physics on the utility of what he or she is doing to physics is, well, maybe. So I want to argue that, in fact, philosophy is not totally useless to physics, both to the general public and to the philosophers, saying, guys, I think as a physicist that you're doing something useful. Not last because on my side of the world, among the physicists, many physicists have argued and are of the opinion that philosophy is completely useless. Right, and have done so quite vocal way in the last period. Let me just flash a couple of examples. You may know this guy, Neil deGrasse Tyson. He's very well known in America, I suppose, also here, a speaker for physics, for science, for physics, and talking to the large public, doing popular science. He has said a number of things about the subject. This is one. We learn about expanding universe, we do. We learn about quantum physics, we do, each of which fails so far out of what you can deduce from your armchair. The armchair is the icon of the philosopher, right? They are now sitting on a chair, but usually they sit on armchair. So it's so far, physics is so far out from what these philosophers do that the whole community of philosophers was rendered essentially obsolete. Well, you may say this is a wonderful person, is a speaker for physics sometimes, but he's not one of the great physicists of the time. So what do the great physicists of the time say? Well, this is Steven Weinberg. This is probably the physicist of the generation before mine that I most I regard with most respect, one of the greatest physicists of his generation. He got a Nobel Prize. He got a Nobel Prize because he's one of the architects of the Standard Model, the basic theory of particle physics. This is a recent book he wrote. You certainly cannot read, but chapter 7, here it is, the title is Against Philosophy. And basically, for the chapter is not a silly chapter. It's a very interesting chapter. He argues that philosophy is not only useless, but damaging for physics. And he has examples of that. And it's is interesting to read. Well, you might say, OK, but these are bloody Americans, right? This side of the ocean, I was going to say Europe, but maybe I shouldn't. this is a very British, very, very British icon of physics, in fact, theoretical physics. Everybody recognized Stephen Hawking, and this is one of his last books. And you probably know at the very beginning of the book, he says, philosophy is dead. And the point he makes is that there were big questions like the origin of the universe, the nature of things, whatever, that were, that's the way he put it, that were the matter of discussion for philosophers. Now it's not anymore because we the physicists are working these things out. Philosophers have nothing to say anymore. So that's the start. Philosophers say, we don't. Maybe we're not very useful to physicists. Physicists say, of course, you're useless. Is that really so? Is philosophy of any use to physics? I want to reflect on that and make a few comments in the opposite direction, which I think are relevant also on what is theoretical physics and what is philosophy. And allow me to before entering the subject, allow me to take a little detour and tell you a story, because I stumbled upon this completely by chance, but I cannot resist sharing this with you. I was preparing this lecture and taking note, and I have my arguments, when completely by chance, by meeting somebody on a bed and breakfast in Toronto one morning, I discovered the following story. So let me give you the full story. It's in Athens a long time ago, 24 centuries ago. And this is the golden moment of Athens. And as many of you know, both sides of the aisle, there was a school there called the Academy, where sort of the golden youth of Athens was educated. And this school had a master. And the master is this guy here, Plato. And the core of the education and the knowledge developed in the school was to sort of study the foundations of all the activities that people did. So the school, they were discussing what is justice, what is beauty, what is et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. How is the world, and so on and so forth. And the name that this guy here, Plato, gave to this idea of education and knowledge was philosophy. He invented the name philosophy. But what perhaps not everybody knows is that that was not the only school in Athens at the time. There were other schools, and in particular, there was a school by Isocrates, who was equal in dignity. There was a strong competition between the two, kind of Oxford and Cambridge, but more than Oxford and Cambridge, because the claim to fame was not only we are the best to educate your children, the clash was about which sort of education had to be given and which sort of knowledge had to be developed in the school. And Isocrates, we have a lot of his text, claimed very strongly that what these guys were doing was bad, useless, and wrong. And that's one of the texts from Isocrates. It says, those who do philosophy, who determine the proofs and the arguments, and in these 2 days of conference, I've heard argument and argument, and are accustomed to inquiring, but take part in none of the practical functions, they don't do physics, even if they happen to be capable of handling something, some of them in fact do understand a little bit of physics, they automatically do it worse. Okay? Whereas, those who have no knowledge of the arguments of philosophy, if they are trained in physics and have correct opinions, if they are decent physicists, are altogether superior for all practical purposes. Hence, and this is his words, philosophy is entirely useless. Okay? So this discussion is a bit old, in fact. But that's not the story. I mean, the story I stumbled upon, it's a continuation of this story, because in Plato school, there was a younger student, young student, who decided to answer to Isocrates and wrote a little text trying to reply to the argument of Isocrates that philosophy is useless. And he wrote a text, this is a student, this is a text. The text is called Protrepticus, which means sort of invitation, exhortation. It's a dialogue in which Aristotle himself, as a character, replies to the negative comments by Isocrates and try to argue why philosophy is used by itself, but especially is used for the practical sciences, for what they call the sciences. Okay, the guy, of course, is Aristotle. But careful, is Aristotle as a young man? The bulk of the texts we have about Aristotle were written much later. After he had quite a career, he went away from Athens. He became the teacher of the master of the world of Alexander. Then he went to the little island in Greece and sort of studied fish and jump-started biology this way. Then he came back to Athens and opened his own school. And we have all the texts in this own school. This text here is the text of young Aristotle that was considered lost. In fact, was lost for. In modern times, was very much read in antiquity. Everybody quotes in antiquity this text by Aristotle, but it was lost. But recently, in the last years, a couple of Aristotle scholars, the name is Monte Johnson and Dutch Mutsen, have claimed that starting from all the scattered texts referring to this Aristotle original text, they've been able to put it together. And they actually, you can go online and find, look for Protrepticus, so you can read Aristotle text. So I did. Okay, I said, here, I'm given a job to defend philosophy against claim that is useless to physics. And the job has already been done by somebody better than me, Aristotle. So I better look at what he does. So Aristotle has a number of arguments, and to my rather, I was quite astonished to see that the argument that I have listed down were in fact just all the Aristotelian idea that was coming out. These are some of the arguments that he mentioned. I'll go through these, them again. So in a sense, much has changed, right? Philosophy today is not exactly what was done in Plato's school, and science today is not what Isocrates called Plato at the time. But nevertheless, some of the arguments go through, and I'm going to look at this argument one by one and use Aristotle organization to present essentially three arguments about the utility or not, or the possible relation between philosophy and physics. So let's get to business. First point, let me change the question. Instead of asking sort of a priori whether philosophy is used to physics or not, let's see what has happened so far and is happening today in the relation between philosophy and physics, right? And then one immediately sees something quite impressive. This is a list of scientists and a major step ahead in what we consider today big science, from ancient astronomy all the way to quantum gravity, which is not yet done through various steps. Now, if you look at these are just more or less randomly chosen as major figures or problems. If you look at these and you ask if there was any relation to philosophy, you get something astonishing. The amount of influence
of philosophy, philosopher, philosophical school, philosopher of science, historian of philosophy, on the actual work of the scientists is enormous. So whether a priori or a posteriori philosophy is used or not to physics, it's a fact that science is strongly influenced by philosophy from the very beginning all the way to today. And I'll just, each one of these lines could be a long story. I'm not covering all these lines. I'll just say something about the beginning and the end. The beginning of astronomy, from which modern astronomy and physics came directly from Plato's school. Eudoxus was strictly connected to Plato's school and got to Ptolemy and then to... When Galileo came from Plato's school but was then based on Aristotle physics. In fact, the name of physics is one of Aristotle's books, right? So to some extent, physics and astronomy are just branching out from the work of ancient philosophers. But when Galileo and Newton restarted science in the modern times, they started from Aristotle, Plato, or Democritus very heavily. Often the story is given by emphasizing the change, the rebellion, the coming out of Aristotelian physics that Galileo or Bacon or Kepler or Copernicus did. But this is emphasizing the details. They changed something, but basically they construct. It's impossible to think of Galileo and Copernicus and Newton without the previous physics on which they were building and where they were changing something. Much more than that, when Galileo starts doing this incredible thing of writing an equation describing how things fall, which is the beginning of modern physics, he's totally influenced by Plato and by abstract Platonic ideas about mathematics being the way in which a veiled reality between the appearances can be expressed. Galileo refers explicitly to Plato. He says, wow, I've seen the Platonic ideal reality beyond the appearances, and that's what I was looking for. He wouldn't have done what he did unless he was deeply influenced by Plato. And Newton has a direct, recognized by himself, influence from Democritus in the idea of empty space, the idea of motion, regular motion, rectilinear, and constant speed as a natural motion, and so on and so on. But that's the beginning. You can say, well, that was the beginning, and then science worked on its own feet. Did it? Let's jump down. Einstein and Heisenberg. This is what we call modern physics. It's actually 1 century old, but still the name is modern physics. This is the greatest pillars of our understanding of fundamental physical world today. Quantum theory and relativity, special generativity. Now, quantum theory started with Heisenberg. The 1925 quantum theory is sort of a collective construction of a number of people, but the key step that allowed us to go into quantum theory as we conceive it today is Heisenberg. Heisenberg 1925 paper, it's a paper which is astonishing in terms of the ideas, because the ideas on which it's based are completely incoherent and different from the ideas in which physics had developed up to that point. And where do these ideas come from? Well, here is what Heisenberg claims. He claims that the theory must only refer to observable quantities. Maxwell would have been horrified by that. It was studying the atoms, right? So atom, you have a nucleus and the electrons around. And Heisenberg says, well, these electrons, which are trying to figure out how they work, the position of the electron, the orbit of the electron, I cannot see them. Therefore, they should not be part of the theory. They don't exist as far as I'm concerned. Where does this incredible idea come from? From the philosophers of his time. This is a pure positivism of the beginning of the 20th century, influencing Heisenberg. Heisenberg grew up in this philosophical atmosphere. He refers to the philosophers at the time. Same Einstein, special relativity, 1905. When he comes out of special relativity, his entire language is a result of the positivist. And he
thanks Mach explicitly, saying that's how I got the ideas. He thinks that space-time should not be assumed a priori as having some structure a priori, so he's reading the criticism to Kant, to Newton, done by the philosophers, not by the physicist, and rethink it in terms of rods and clock, observable things. And not only that, but if you read the paper, the main point is that simultaneity, right? Two things happening, one here and one there. You cannot say which happened first, or you cannot say if they happen at the same time, unless you give a definition of same time in terms of procedures of some sort. Where does it get this incredible idea? From Poincaré, from Poincaré philosopher, conventionalism. In Poincaré, there is a discussion. What does it mean to say that two things are simultaneous? It means only that you can make a procedure that. So the ideas come directly from philosophical consideration. Even more in generativity. Generativity is, in my opinion, the best of what we have discovered recently about the world. It's spectacularly beautiful, it's a great step ahead with respect to before. Einstein gets to it in 1915, 10 years after special relativity, and where does he get the ideas? Well, he reconsider criticism to the Newtonian notion of space that he reads in the philosophers once again. It's exactly Leibniz and through the line Berkeley Mach. Gets to Einstein. So this is again a set of philosophical ideas that strongly influence Einstein, and Einstein says that openly. But there is more about Einstein, and perhaps this is the most shocking of all. Einstein says in an interview that while he was doing relativity, he had a book next to his bed. And before sleeping, he was reading that book all the time because it was important for his work. And you know what this book is? It's Schopenhauer. So who would think that Schopenhauer has anything useful to say to science? Well, there's some recent work on history of physics of somebody who tried to figure out what actually Einstein took from Schopenhauer. Schopenhauer talks about time, representation, so it's not impossible. But whatever is the actual influence, no doubt that Einstein claims that Schopenhauer is crucial for his doing. So I'm not saying here that physicists could do that. Philosophers could do the work of physicists. No, right? I mean, Heisenberg did quantum mechanics. Einstein did these things. And I'm not claiming neither that this is a good philosophy and the other is a bad philosophy. That's not the point. I'm saying that in the work of physicists, in the major steps, there is an enormous input that comes from philosophy at all points in the evolution of physics. Why? Well, that's what I'm going to talk from now on. Philosophers are good, at least today's philosophers, are particularly good in doing this kind of thing, conceptual analysis, find out where there is mistakes in reasoning, discovering what's wrong in general arguments, but especially are using in opening up other possibilities, seeing things from a different perspective. This has happened over and over in the history of our culture, and the person who says this more clearly, I think, is Einstein himself. This is a letter, a late letter. He says, this, I think, is a key point in this sort of number one argument I have. A knowledge of the historic and philosophical background gives that kind of independence from prejudice of his generation from which most scientists are suffering. Now, this is very interesting. This is the opposite of what Weinberger and Hawking are saying. Physicists in one generation are trapped in a way of thinking, and from philosophy they get new perspective. Philosophy is more capable of physics because of its matter of working, because of the training of philosopher, because it's in its subject, in coming out from prejudices and giving different perspective. And that's extraordinarily useful for physicists. In fact, Einstein says this independence created a philosophical insight, created by philosophical insight, is, in my opinion, in Einstein's opinion, the mark of distinction between a mere artisan or specialist and a real seeker after truth. He's making a difference here. The scientists and scientists, those who work in some detail, and maybe they don't need philosophy. There are others that try to look more far away, and that philosophy plays a role. And this is a citation which I think captured a little bit the, I don't know where it comes from. I've read it somewhere, I can't say. If somebody knows where it comes from, please tell me. But I think it captures, scientists don't do anything unless they first get permission from philosophy. It's true, because of what Einstein said, a scientist is trapped in a way of thinking, and then philosophy suggests other possible way of thinking. This is the first point. Let me go to the second point. In the second point, it's a slightly different from the first, but perhaps it's much more important. And it explained the first more. Aristotle says two things. I'm going to show you the second in a moment, but let me start from this. This is how Aristotle actually opens his book, and it's very pretty. So let me play it on these guys here, the same trick that Aristotle is playing on Isocrates. This is the discovery, main discovery of Weinberg, the physics of the electromagnetic and weak interactions, those of the radioactive decay, are invariant under a certain group. This is the main discovery of Hawking. Hawking has discovered the black holes are hot and has computed the temperature of this black hole. Temperature TTH, T Hawking, temperature of Hawking. It's a number of constants, Planck constant, speed of light, Newton constant, Boltzmann constant, and then it's proportional to the 1 over the mass. So big hot, big black hole cold, small black hole hot. That's the claim to fame of Hawking. Well, when these guys do this, they are doing physics. They're doing science, no doubt. Okay. When they write philosophy is useless, philosophy is dead, what are they doing? Well, they're doing philosophy in the sense they're doing something which is not science. Maybe one day there will be a science of how to do physics, but for the moment we don't have a science how to do physics. And the people who discuss how physics is done are usually philosophers. So they're doing philosophy. Now, there's nothing bad in the fact that they do philosophy. But are they capturing the universal way? Are they saying, okay, now we know what is to do science. Okay, and this is obviously what Galileo would have said, what Newton would have said, what everybody today would say. No, right? They're giving one particular take on what is to do science. So they're doing one particular kind of philosophy. They have one particular philosophical perspective on what is it to do science. Where did they get it from? Well, they get it from Kuhn, from Popper, from Kuhn, from logical positivism, from the philosophers. Okay. Again, nothing wrong in that, that's good, but that's what is happening. They have read the philosophers, or they have read something, somebody who has read the philosopher, or they were sitting in a class, more probably as young boys, and some professor has told them, you know, science is this, A, B, C, D. They have absorbed that, they've used it, it's science, good science, wonderful science, and they buy a vision of science, a certain vision of science, which was developed by the philosophers. Which, by the way, is completely different than the vision of science that Maxwell would have had, or Faraday would have had, or Newton would have had. It's completely different. Newton would have said philosophy is dead, okay? Or Maxwell, or Einstein, or Heisenberg, or Bohr, to the opposite. Science is much bigger than them, say the opposite. So what is the point here? The point here is that when scientists do physics, they also do philosophy when they reflect on what they are doing. So philosophy, apart from the fact that it gives good idea to science, which was point one, it's a discussion about what it is to do science, of the methodology of doing science, how science is done. And the point, I'm not going through all that, but the point is that the idea of the scientist, of how science is done and what is to do science, changes from generation to generation. Keep evolving. It started off with Ptolemy to describe the circles
around the Earth, and then it was a wrong problem, and then it was describe the circles around the Sun, it was a wrong problem, and then it was to find out the forces between the particles, it was a wrong problem because there are fields, and then and so on and so forth. I mean, after relativity, well, we haven't understood, it's just a deterministic dynamical equation of space, time, fields. No, it's a wrong problem because quantum mechanics is undeterministic. So the problem gets redefined continuously, and the very nature of what is science keeps being redefined. Maybe science is finding the ultimate constituents of nature. Or maybe it's just accounting for regularity on empirical observations. It's a completely different philosophy. And scientists shift from one to the other, to other, still other. The last one is the one I like, search for the most effective conceptual scheme for making sense of the world and changing, updating here. What is the point here? Science is a project which is not well clearly defined, circumscribed with a fixed methodology. It's a project in the making. It's an evolving adventure that's trying to make sense of the world. And the methodology itself changes, evolves, is not fixed. And sometimes something is going to be useful, sometimes something else is going to be useful. And in that, the reflection, the continuous discussion of philosophy of science on what it is to do science has an enormous influence of the scientists themselves, who change their mind according to what they hear, what comes to be useful at some point. And that's good. That's very good. But that means that philosophy of science is continuously crossing paths with science and having enormous influence on science. To the point, let me argue this. Let me say in this language. This is a simple way of seeing what a scientist does. This is a scientist who has some data. Data, I mean observations, measurement, whatever. And develop theories. And of course, there's a complicated back and forth between data and theories. In some sense, data suggests theories, not clear how. At some point it was clear, but then it's not clear anymore. Theories make sense of the data, but then are checked against the data, and so on and so forth. And we have new data, right? We just discovered the gravitational waves. So with the gravitational waves, we're going to see fantastic new things of the universe. We'll have new data. And presumably, we'll have to change the theory, so theory evolves. That's a story. That's one story. Is that the full story? Not at all. Why? Because this makes believe that the scientist is a sort of perfect rational being that juggles between this and that, and his mind is clear like a Renaissance man. But this is not the case, because a scientist has its own conceptual framework. He has ideas about what is space, what is time, what is causality, what it means to be objective, what is observation, language use, and so on and so forth. And it is a historical truth that all these things are affected by what goes down here. When Einstein discovered that simultaneity is different than what we thought, it changed completely what we mean by time. When Heisenberg does quantum mechanics, it changed something up there. When Kepler discovers that the trajectory of the planetary ellipses, it changed something in the conceptual structure, what it meant to be to do science at that time. So this evolves as well. There's a back and forth between this and that. And in this conceptual remanaging continuous of the work that the scientist is doing, the conceptual structure that the scientist is doing, it's obvious that there is a back and forth with philosophy continuous. So that's the last comment about this. This is so strong, which I think this is an example, in my opinion, of bad influence of philosophy on science. Kuhn is a great historian of science, a great philosopher of science, has convinced all the physicists. Today, all the physicists are Kuhnian. They forgot that there was a previous philosophy of science, and they don't know nothing of subsequent philosophy of science. So they're all Kuhnian. And therefore, they all think, a la Kuhn, that science is about revolutions in which the entire conceptual structure is thrown away and reconstructed. That was a great discovery by Kuhnian, but in fact, I believe, and I think it's pretty obvious, that science is not so simplistic. It's a little bit more complicated. There's much more continuity in the history of science and in the evolution of the theory than the discontinuity that Kuhn has emphasized. With the result that today, a lot of intellectual energy is wasted by fishing completely new conceptual structure here and there and forgetting to look for new theories in the knowledge that we have. So far from science and philosophy being disconnected, there is an enormous back and forth between the two, in the good and in the bad. And that's the way Aristotle put it. Philosophy provides guidance, good and bad, on how research must be done. Last point. Third point, and then I have a conclusive remark, and then I'm done. So the third argument, that's the way Aristotle put it. More in need of philosophy are the sciences where perplexities are greater. So Aristotle is saying, wait a minute, yeah, philosophy is useful for science, but depends, sometime more, sometime less. And let's translate this in modern terms, in fact, using Kuhn ideas. That's Kuhn's famous book. Kuhn has this story about science evolving in moments of big change in which the paradigm is modified in Kuhnian terms. Certainly, there are moments in which things change more dramatically. And that's are precisely the moments in which the intersections between philosophy are stronger, because that's where the foundations are shaken, rearranged, and philosophy cares about foundations, that's what the job of these people are, and that's when the discord. So when does this happen? For instance, it happened now, right? Because now in fundamental physics, we are in a typical Kuhnian crisis moment, because quantum mechanics and generativity don't talk to one another. And we have to bring them together. And to bring them together, what does it mean? So there's a 5 minutes quantum gravity quantum gravity 101. This is space-time before generativity. Then comes Einstein and says, no, these curves. Here is a space-time curves. This is the discovery of Einstein. And quantum mechanics tell us that all things that have a dynamics are granular, are probabilistic, and are fluctuating somehow. So easily, space-time, that's quantum gravity, becomes granular, probabilistic, and fluctuating. Okay, this is pretty a big thing, right? Because you have to rechange everything. What does it mean, a fluctuating probabilistic granular time? Okay. Let's put it another way. This is how physics changed its answer to the question, how is the world made? For Newton, there's particles moving in space and time. Then comes Faraday and adds a field. Then special relativity unify space and time in some of this stuff, which is space-time. Quantum mechanics shows that particles are just excitation of fields, so there are these funny things which are quantum fields that are continuous but manifest themselves as particles. Generativity tells us space-time is a field, and quantum gravity, you want to put it all together, so you have a single object, a quantum relativistic field, out of which space, time, particles, everything should come out in some way. Do we know how to do that clearly? No. We are in a Kuhnian crisis. So this is a theory on which I'm working, loop quantum gravity, in one attempt to solve this problem. These are the basic equations of the theory written in a compact form. There's no x, there's no t, which means that space and time are not here. They have to emerge from that. Geometry is not here, they have to merge. There are no objects, because object is something that permeates in time. There's nothing that permeates in time, there's no time. So object emerge, and there's a funny weakening of realism, because the theory describes only how things interact with one another instead of what they are. Is this clear? No. And that's the point. Quantum gravity demands us to rethink the notion of space-time, observable causality, confirmation. And that's why I am a physicist. I'm particularly keen to talk to these guys, right? Because as philosophers, they work on this kind of thing. And the number of problems that philosophers of physics, or philosophers in general sometimes, and physicists are addressing in moments like that, the common problems, is enormous. This is my book with some... This is a list of problems discussed. I'm not going to go through all this. What is space? What is time? These were discussed by physicists in the past, but they're being rediscussed because we know something more, so we have to change the way of thinking about that. These are some of the physicists that were forced to discuss this problem. And this is some of the philosophers in the past and in the present who discuss this, these things, including things you wouldn't expect. There is a recent direction of thinking in quantum gravity, which is whether we can think of the laws themselves as something that evolve in some sense. Great idea that comes from Peirce, American pragmatist. Would you think that American pragmatists have something useful to say? Maybe. Okay. So all these topics here, what's space, what is time, are physical entities real, what do we mean by reality, what is a quantum wave function, methodological thing, what counts as a confirmation of a theory, what makes a theory credible, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, all things which are discussed, for instance, in this conference, which is the occasion of this meeting, the Conference Foundation of Physics, or in the journal that was mentioned before, Foundation of Physics. So this is a complete overlap between philosophical interests and interests of physics, and definitely physics uses philosophy. I don't know if it needs this, but it uses heavily. I want to take a couple more minutes for a final comment. However, so let me also say something in the opposite direction, which is the following. There is physics and physics, and there's philosophy and philosophy. And philosophy, it's a wide area which includes all sorts of things. And some of these have nothing to do with what I've said so far. Okay. In fact, some of these are remarkable away and far away from what I've said so far. In philosophy, I'm not going to do anything general, I'm just going to give a couple of absolutely minimal flashes. In philosophy, there is a wide area of contemporary philosophy which have had a strong effect, whose ideas permeated in the society, claiming that science is irrelevant. That's one example. That's Heidegger. It's major. I'm not even reading that because it makes me nervous. But what he says essentially is that, look, the world that scientists describe is not our world. Science is non-authentic, non-genuine description of the world. It's irrelevant. It's even bad because it's technology, and that's what ruins us. I'm caricaturing a little bit. But these ideas go around, and I'll comment about this. I was interviewed by a Swiss radio not long ago, and the interviewer said, okay, so you're a physicist. Physics is obviously irrelevant for our world. Why should we care about what you do? In a different area of contemporary culture, that lies across Atlantic once more, this is sociology. This is I'm just making flashes. This is a rather famous book by this guy, Pickering, in which he analyzes physics and argues, said in a stupid way, that knowledge in physics is nothing else than a complicated game that the physicists want to play on the rest of society or something like that. It concludes, but that's what he says, that there is no obligation upon anyone framing a view of the world to take account of what 20th century science has to say, okay? Maybe Darwin is 19th century, so that's still taken into account. When I read this kind of things, I have the impression of somebody studying what happened in a music concert and very carefully analyzing the movement of the director, the movement of the people playing, the attitude of the people, and noticing a lot of two things, very, very, okay, the way people are dressed, what it means, the signal that they're exchanging one another, the social roles, how they play, the power role, how they play, okay, all this true, all this. Forgetting that there's something going on, it's the music, okay? Somebody deaf who's analyzing. So sociology of science is fantastic, except that it forgets science, the content of what, and that's quite interesting, in fact. And on the basis of that, all this, this is very minimal, right? I don't want to enter now. There is an attitude which I think is quite diffused in society, which comes from here, which is to say, of course the physicists are not, the scientists, are not capable of solving this problem, this problem, this problem, okay? True, an immense number of things that we don't know. So here is the situation. They remind me of the two ladies here. And another thing, Francis, all these scientists pretending to be capable of studying consciousness or the beginning of the universe, of course they cannot understand these things. We do. the point I'm making is that if there is an enormous influence on good philosophy, on science, there is an enormous influence of science on good philosophy. You could not even think about Hume or Kant or positive, all these people, unless we're talking about the Western civilization here, unless you remember how, think about Kant. Kant was all a reaction about what Newton has and around Newton was discovered about the world. But even the part of philosophy which are even phenomenology, Husserl, if you open this book, he says, science is fantastic, I want to try to copy science as much as possible because that's a good way of addressing a problem. So good philosophers listen to science simply because science is the best that we know about the world at this moment and try to build on that. Ignoring that is ignoring what is about what we know about the world. And I think the part of science that in our philosophy is shallow, but the part of philosophy that ignores science, it's just ignorant and silly, because it's like trying to make sense of the world on the basis of the knowledge of something of the 15th century. You just ignore facts, real facts that we know about the world. So that's my conclusions. I made 3 points about the utility of the relation between philosophy and physics, and a final comment. The first is that de facto is a fact. It doesn't make sense to discuss whether a priori something is useful or not. It's a fact that there is an enormous influence of philosophy into physics, much more than is commonly assumed, and much more seems to me that my philosopher friends are aware of. I got questions. Really, the physicists are influenced by Kuhn? Of course, they are immensely, enormously. Second, physics is continuous conceptual reorganization, and especially continuous methodological reorganization. It's not stable, the philosophy of physics, the foundations of physics. They are continuous in change. And that's why the dialogue is so essential. Third, this is particularly true today because of quantum gravity, because foundational things like what it means space, time, observation, system, subsystem are being re-questioned. And the final comment is that philosophical uninformed science is shallow, but a philosophy that disregard or discount scientific knowledge is silly and pretentious. We know they don't. So yes, physics need philosophy, and philosophy need physics. Culture is integral and organic. Thank you.
Time for questions.
Okay.
If you have a question, please raise your hand and wait until the mic reaches you. Okay. The lady in the middle with the green stripes, please.
Thank you. Thanks. Lovely talk. Thank you. And could you say that the need for science is itself a philosophy?
I didn't get it.
That science itself is a philosophy, the need to do science, the human interest in science, as opposed to just living and not caring.
Yes, if you use the words in their wide meaning, it certainly is. I mean, that certainly, the word philosophy was introduced by Plato
And it certainly meant a desire of knowing, which is exactly the same desire of knowing that has fired the development of what is philosophy of science. Philosophy and science were mixed and not clearly recognized, certainly all the way until Newton and after. Newton would call himself a natural philosopher. The expression scientist is later. But nevertheless, there is a clear specialization that has happened. And there are different tools, different domains, so the fields are completely clearly recognizable. And that's good, because everybody does what is good at doing. But yes, the common source is the same and is philosophical in a sense.
The gentleman here, fourth row. There. Yes.
Wonderful talk. It seems to me there's another argument for saying that science, physics needs philosophy that you didn't mention, and I want to hear your opinion of it. In physics, physicists only ever, or nearly only ever, accept unified theories. Physicists don't ignore, usually ignore, what one might call patchwork quilt theories that say one set of laws for phenomena over here, another set of laws for phenomena over here, another set of laws for phenomena over here. But you can always concoct theories like that, deliberately concocted to fit the phenomena even better, to be empirically more successful than the theories we accept. Doesn't that mean that in accepting unified theories, in a sense against the evidence, means that a big assumption, a metaphysical assumption, a philosophical assumption about the universe is being made? Namely, the universe is such that all patchwork quilts theories are false, or that there's some kind of underlying unity in nature, or that the universe is in some way or other physically comprehensible. And physicists tend to be, you know, a bit sort of, this tends to be brushed under the carpet. But it's, in a sense, a metaphysical, so a philosophical doctrine, and it means philosophy is kind of integral to physics in a way that you didn't mention. Do you agree?
Yes, I agree that I didn't mention it. You touch a crucial point. You touch a very, very interesting point. So let me just very briefly answer in steps. I think that physics, the way it's actually developed, is full of metaphysical assumptions. Is full of metaphysical assumptions. Is nurtured by metaphysical assumptions. When Galileo starts modern physics by seeing, looking at the, he doesn't discover an equation. He believes that there is an equation before discovering it, because he's full of Plato and Pythagoras in his head. So it has a metaphysical assumption about nature. Nature had to be such that I can describe it by math, and I want to find it. Okay. In my opinion, science is at best when it uses this metaphysical assumption, but is aware of them and is not too committed to them, and is capable of shifting. Because very often, the difficulty of going ahead has been the difficulty of dropping something that was considered to be one of the non-negotiable beliefs about the world. Unification is one. Yes, physics has strived by unification, but the current emphasis on unification, which was not there in the past, is more motivated by the success of a certain historical unification moves that has happened, electricity and magnetism, the Standard Model, nature of light understood together with ethical humanities. So the great enthusiasm about physicists for unification, I don't like much unification. I think that physicists who are too much driven toward unification, they might much be going after something which is not at our reach at this point. So I think we cannot do without prejudices. the best is to recognize them as much as possible as prejudices and be ready to change them.
Thank you. Gentlemen, second row, blue.
Yeah, thanks for the talk. Personally, I don't think that philosophy has merely made any significant strides since Hume, but then I tend to be an extreme empiricist. But I don't know if you're aware how, particularly the situation in philosophy of mind, you may say that's not part of physics, but it's potentially something to do with science and how the brain works and how perception and our relation to the world. Most of the top names in London philosophy are, and this amazes me, they are externalists, and say that in philosophical parlance, they believe that colours, smells, sounds, and so on are actually out there in the world. Now that seems to be amazing because it seems that since the 17th century at least, and even Democritus, you know, saying, you know, actually they're only atoms in the void, for philosophers to teach some doctrine that there's that colours, sounds, smells are external to us rather than some function of how we are conscious, which is a deep mystery, of course, and you know, challenges physicalism as an ontology. Well, it just strikes me as amazing, as I say, and it seems to me that the philosophers are willfully ignoring what is taught to us, basically, in early secondary school science. And there's no hyperbole here. I mean, I've been sampling this over 20 years, and I'm astonished at this. So I don't know if you have any comments on that.
Well, yeah, philosophy of mind is a kind of worm, and I don't want to go into it. Just two comments. One is that there's a lot of work in science about, and there's a lot of work in philosophy, and it seems to me, once again, that on both sides, the best part of the work is what keeps what happened on the other side and well in. But I want to make one comment. All of the current science about the mind, the brain, cognitive sciences, it's just an immense influence by Hume, right? If you just read Hume, you read all the basic assumptions on which today cognitive sciences work. Once again, maybe also Spinoza, but in a more less evident way. The ideas come once again from philosophy, which then a lot of cognitive science developed and work, and it seems to me that the best part of today's philosophy of mind. I've recently been excited by a book about free will by Ismail, a woman philosopher in America, who seems to be a very great book by a philosopher about free will. And one reason it's great is because it's profoundly informed by what is going on in the cognitive science of the people studying the brain. It's something which we don't understand well, but once again, the exchange of ideas is, I think, what can help us to get clarity of some confusion, which we certainly have on the topic.
Can I come back? I'm sorry, no. In the middle. Michael, raise your hand, please. So
oh, a question from the philosophers.
Yes.
So some of the figures you mentioned, so Newton, for example, and Leibniz in particular, but some of the others as well. So we think of Newton as a scientist, but it's not clear when you really look at him whether, like, was he more of a scientist or was he more of a philosopher? And similarly for Leibniz. And there are many figures throughout the history of philosophy and science that were had dual aspects of them. So I'm just wondering what you think. Do you think that's desirable? Do you think that it's desirable for one person to be both, to have feet in both science and philosophy, or do you think a division of labor is more desirable?
It's certainly desirable for one person to be both. I don't think it's attainable today. It would be wonderful, right, to be Aristotle. You do the physics, you do the logic, you do the. I don't think anybody's capable today of doing anything like that. Leibniz certainly was close to that. Newton had some. I don't know. Descartes certainly contributed to both. There are Poincaré has some fantastic science and some. there is clearly a difference of style, a different education, a different demarcation, a separation in the way different fields work. Certainly, a lot of characters are not clearly cannot be clearly framed in one or the other discipline, and this is just I would take it as a comment in support of the argument that we're not talking about two different things. We're talking about two different ways of thinking that have strong intersection.
Thank you. Gentleman in the middle, red, green shirt.
Green. Green, blue, green.
Okay, thank you. The list of philosophers you gave informing science or developing the physical models kind of stopped in the mid-20th century. I think Quine was the last mentioned. And I was wondering which philosophies qua philosophy either implicitly or externally put pressure on physics?
I can tell you a number of philosophers which I personally read and had a strong influence on me. It's hard to see. I mean, it's like, you know, who's saying who are the great artists today? Well, just wait a century, and then it will be easier but I don't know. Certainly David Lewis, certainly Hugh Price, certainly Quine, certainly Putnam. Certainly these are all example of philosophers, or among more young, I don't know. Van Frassen had an influence on me from very different size and from very different. I read and I learned something useful, which had me rethink certain things. I tried not to mention any of these guys because I mentioned one. There is a part of certainly what is called analytical philosophy in general is much more close to science than what is called continental philosophy, to the extent in which there still is a division of that sort. Until the middle of the 20th century, there was more explicit attention between the two discipline, especially in physics. Physics, in a sense, after the 30s, after the war, took a direction, we don't care about philosophy anymore. Maybe under the influence of American pragmatism. But if you read Feynman and Gell-Mann and the great scientists of the second half of the century, they're much more distant from philosophy. One of the reasons is simply because after general relativity and quantum mechanics, for a while, it was sort of, maybe I'm exaggerating a little bit, but a Kuhnian normal science. You just have to apply these new things, and now we are back to, so now the dialogue restart. But on the other direction as well, perhaps in the large body of analytical philosophy, the philosophy of science has been a little bit more disconnected from the rest of analytical philosophy. However, I do find the discussion about metaphysics today in analytical philosophies relevant, interesting. It doesn't mean that I agree or disagree, maybe that's not the point. But they raise the point, all the discussion of what it means to be existent, it's, for a physicist, is important because we're working with the notion of existence, right? Do quark exist? Do my quanta of space exist? In which sense? So if I get good ideas, I can maybe use them.
One more question from the right side of philosophy or foundations of physics crowd.
Yeah.
So thank you for a very interesting and sensitive talk. And I'm now very excited to go back to my armchair and think. Good thoughts, but now I have a bit of a phobia.
Yeah, that's what these guys do, right? Very good, but.
because I want to think of good philosophy, not bad philosophy. And before you come back and tell me that it's my job to define these things, let me tell you a quick story. I listened to Ed Witten give a talk to mathematicians a few years ago, and he had very definite ideas that the mathematicians were all doing bunk and they should listen to him and do what he said so they can do something that will help physics out. Maybe if you can give a more sensitive notion of what good philosophy is, what do you think we should be thinking about? And what sort of questions would make good philosophy rather than bad?
The last thing I want to do is to do what Witten does.
Applause from the right.
But what I wish philosophers of science do, I mean, they certainly are doing, I had a list of questions, a long list of questions. These are questions which have been discussed in the foundations of physics community at large, and I think this is a very relevant question. I would like scientists, philosophers, help me answer the question, is this viable? So take the confusion of string theory today. Is this viable or what's wrong? Take loop quantum gravity today. There is no space, no time, no this. Does this make sense? You guys are so much better than us physicists in asking the right questions. Look, you're doing that, but there's missing. There's obviously something wrong. There's obviously something that you're saying one thing. You're using a term in different ways. You're making a set of arguments that don't stay together. So in other words, not just look at non-relativistic quantum mechanics, but also not just look at quantum field theories. Look at quantum gravity. Look at the new things. Look at inflation. Look at pre-Big Bang cosmology. I know that's shaky ground, horrendously shaky ground. So. Maybe some inputs are maybe useful. I don't know. That's one first thing that comes to my mind.
The last question, no strings there, here. Lady, in the middle.
Thank you. So is it kind of thing that we need philosophy in physics for all of unsolved problem, okay, but we don't need philosophy in physics for all of solved problem? Suppose we have explanation for the gravitational law, and we have explanation in the some quantum phenomena, suppose Planck equation, when electron go in lower state from the higher state, so you can explain this phenomena in E equal to hb, which Planck did. So, but in the wave particle duality, we don't have any kind of, I mean, perfect explanations. We have some kind of, when you measure the particles, when you try to measure its momentum and position within the same time, you can't explain. So sometimes it behaves like particles, sometimes it behaves like web. So what you can say is kind of, if we don't have any kind of explanation or any kind of equation, then you can philosophize. When you find any kind of explanation and equation, then there is no way to philosophize. Did you get it?
Yeah, in a sense, yes. In a sense, yes, because what you're saying is that when we already think we have clarity, we're just happy and we don't need, where we do not have clarity, that's the moment in which philosophy comes to be useful. And that's the moment in which philosophy has come in the past in the history of physics. Every time there was a lack of clarity, physicists tried to get some inspiration from philosophers, either by changing the problem, often, or by having some hint of how the problem.
I'm sorry, you don't have the mic, so we won't hear you, and I think we should be stopping that. This is really the last question. Yes, the gentleman there.
Thank you for the wonderful lecture. I was wondering, to what extent are you just seeing things when you want to see them? Because instead of philosophy in physics, I could have said philosophy in in economics. Because, you know, philosophy says a lot of things that are pointless and useless. So you could always pick something that are relevant to your subject. So, yeah, I was just wondering, because to the biblical scholars, everything, you could always find a passage in the Bible that says that's relevant to your situation. So, you know, I could have just said philosophy and economics or philosophy and chemistry or philosophy and whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, thank you for this for this question. No, it's a very good point. In fact, I thought about that. I thought while preparing this lecture, I thought about that. At some point in my list of things, say, wait, I might just think that. I don't know anything about economics, so I don't know at all how much. Sorry, because we are in the London School of Economics here. I should, but I would say definitely not. When the situation is, let me go in detail, is not at all that, oh, Einstein had said this thing, there's no Newtonian space, and look, Leibniz had already said these things. That's not the point. It's not that Heisenberg said, okay, I don't want to look at the non-existing things, and look, there was already this philosopher saying that, I don't know, Carnap or whatever. It's totally different what I'm saying. I'm saying that Einstein got this idea from Mach. He read Mach, and he says, I read Mach, and I got this idea. And Heisenberg got this idea from the philosophers. So there is a direct filiation between some of the steps I had in physics and some philosophical ideas. So I think it's not just ideas reappearing and good citations. I think there is a direct influence which has, I don't think, in the good and the bad, I don't think that what some scientists say about their own discipline happens to be the same of what Kuhn said. I think that scientists never said that before Kuhn, and after Kuhn, Kuhn idea went to the academy, spread around, scientists were educated in that and therefore think this way. So I want to claim that there is a direct influence, a strong direct influence of ideas in both directions.
Thank you very much. I think we should stop here. Thank you very much for coming. It was a wonderful lecture.